Hi everyone. Instead of digging deep into what OBA is and all the concepts, today I am going to cover the basic concepts of data warehousing so that you can understand where OBA stands and what will be your role in business. Okay. Let us start with the main basics of data warehousing, like what is a data warehouse and where it is used and what are the main uses of that data warehouse. So let us start with the first word in data warehouse, that is data. Each and every business runs on some kind of data, whatever the business may be. It may be a retail business, or it may be a banking, or it may be insurance, or anything. If our business is running, it's an indication for us that it generates some data. Like if you are running a shop, we are going to sell something to the customer, then it is nothing but a transaction and it generates some data. Okay, so each and every business involves lot of data. Let's start with the first word, that is data. Here, any meaningful information is called as data. But in terms of data warehousing perspective, or in terms of these business perspectives, data is divided into two types, that is transactional data, and the other data is analytical data. Transactional data is data that is generated out of transactions, that is let us say I am running a retail chain like Reliance Fresh now. So every day around 100 to 500 customers are visiting my store regularly, and they will be purchasing some their regular household goods there. So as they are coming into my store and they are generating some kind of transactions, all these transactions will be stored in some database. So whenever the customer comes, he generates us some data. So all this data is nothing but a transaction that has been done by the customer. So this kind of data is called as transactional data. But at the end of that month, I want to analyze my business, like what are my profits, how many sales I have done, what is my current stock in my warehouse, and all kind of such things. So at the end of the month, we need an analyzed report in order to improve our business. So analytical data is nothing but data that is generated from lot of transactions. At the end of the month, we will be summing up all the entire transactions that has undergone for that particular month. So is that clear for everyone? What is the difference for this transactional data and analytical data? Harish? Harish?
That's fine. Okay.
Okay, fine. Now let's dig into detail what this transactional data is as per theoretical definitions. Only for the first 2 days, it will be more theoretical. From the third day, it will be most of the what will be like practical sessions, because we are not much bothered about theory. So based upon this above example, now we are going to see what this transactional data is. Transactional data is nothing but runtime data. That is, this transactional data will be generated while our business is in running mode, and this transactional data is used to run the business. And say this transactional data will be like current and detail. Like in the store, the customer is coming and he is purchasing some goods, and there we will be saving each and every detail, like the customer, at what time the transaction has been done, at what time the invoice has been generated, and each and every detail to detail, we will be storing it in a database. So whatever the data that is generated in these transactions, it will be like current and detail. And even the stock that has been maintained in our store, even the stock will be like current and retail, because if a particular stock is not available, and we should have an information that this particular stock is not available, and we need to place an order for the franchisee to fill that stock. So transaction data will be very detailed. But whereas at the end of the month, we are not much worried, or we are not much bothered about this, the details like at what time the customer is coming, or what is the some many other details of the customer will also be captured there. We are not very much bothered about the that kind of data. Why? Because the business analysts need data like their end of the month sales and their end of the month stocks and their percentage of profit that they have achieved that month. So let's put it this as an example, because this kind of transaction will be present in each and every business. That may be an e-commerce business, banking, or any other thing. Let us jump into analytical data. Analytical data is like historical data that is useful to analyze the business. That may be the history that is for a month, or else. Okay. Rajesh is asking here what this OLTP is. I'm sorry, I left that. I missed that point. OLTP is nothing but whatever the transactions that are generated in runtime. That is, whatever the transaction that is generated runtime in a, like the for the example that we have discussed in a Reliance store, everything will be online transactions, right? If a customer at store A has generated some transaction at store A, and some customer has generated some transaction at store B, whatever the transactions that may be, all the transactions will be online transactions, and all this data will be live. If a particular person has purchased Fair & Lovely, we have in our stock 10 products of Fair & Lovely are available in our stock, and whenever that person purchased a single product, then immediately that data will get updated there. That is, 10 minus 1, 9 will be present in the database. So all these kind of transactions, they will be stored in a database that is called as OLTP database. OLTP stands for Online Transactional Processing. OLTP stands for Online Transactional Processing. All these online transactions will get stored in OLTP database. Is that clear?
Yes.
Okay, now let's move on to analytical data. All the analytical data will be stored in a database called as Online Analytical Processing Database, that is OLAP database. And generally, they will not use this term OLAP. Mostly, they will be call it as a data warehouse. Coming to organizational perspective, all this OLTP database, they will maintain in some different kind of systems, like for example, like employees data, they will maintain it in Oracle database. Most of these transactional data will get generated through applications like sales applications, like logistics applications, or maybe this banking applications and all. The source for this transactional data is applications. And whatever the data that is present in transactional data, they will get updated frequently depending upon the business transactions. And the source for this analytical data is OLTP, that is transactional data. We will be scheduling the data loads for this data warehouse periodically. That transactions of this current business day at the night, they will schedule a load, and they will be transferring all the data that is present in OLTP database to OLAP database. I will provide a clear explanation on this, whatever that these data loads and all, in the coming slides. So it is clear up to here, right? What is transactional data and what is analytical data?
Yes.
Okay, now let's move on to a data warehouse. A data warehouse is nothing but a place or area where we store stock of all our transactional data. And after watching this name data warehouse, a lot of questions will arise in our mind, like what is data warehouse, why data warehouse, what purpose does it resolve, and how do we create this data warehouse. So let's discuss about this first question. What is data warehouse? Generally, warehouse is a place where we store our stock in general perspective. But in terms of data warehouse, it is a single place where we store whatever the data, entire organizational data will be stored in a data warehouse. What I mean to say is, like we are running a business where we have all the, any business will have customers. In order to maintain details of customers, we will be maintaining a CRM platform, like customer resource management platform, something like that. So this CRM data will be present in, like they will be using a CRM tool like PeopleSoft. Okay? And they will be maintaining employees' data in some other CRM tool. Yes?
I got one question for this.
Yeah.
So you're saying about data warehouse, which stores the analytical data, right?
Yes. Data warehouse will whatever the data that is generated in transactions, all this dot data in transactions, at the end of the day, they will be transferred to data warehouse.
Including transaction details also?
Including transaction details. But we are not going to copy in a detailed level there. Whatever the data that is needed for our business analysis at the end of the day, only that data will be transferred into data warehouse.
Okay, what about the rest of the data which comes because of transactions, like which card we used and for which bank we swiped the card from which bank?
Yes, because all these whatever the card details and all, they will be just used for us. Why? Because like we are running a store, all these card details and transactions, what we need a confirmation is, we will be connected to a web service of that bank, and we'll be getting a confirmation from the bank that these card details are correct and the transaction is processed and the amount is processed into your account. There we have our sales details there and the source of our transaction, that is, it may be card payment or direct cash payment. So we are not much bothered about his account number and all, right?
Okay.
As per the business of our store. So this kind of data will not get, will not be stored. But in a real time scenario, we'll have record all this data even. Just for an example, basics.
Okay. Where is the data stored for the transactions? Like, if I buy any item, and I use my card. You'll be sending us the invoice, right? For that invoice, we'll be needing all this information.
If it is like e-commerce store, then we need to capture that details even, like what is the card number, because if you raise any kind of returns or something, they need to process your amount back. If it is like e-commerce transaction, we need to maintain that detail even. Depending upon the business, we will plan these kind of loads.
Okay. For e-commerce, let's say example, for e-commerce, it will be stored in data warehouse, including that analytical data.
No. Initially, whatever the transactions that are generated, they will be present in this OLTP only, like in the transactional data.
Okay.
But this analytical data, they will be loading this data, analytical data to, sorry, this transactional data to data warehouse. In the coming slides, you will get to understand that clearly.
Okay.
Because I will be explaining with an architectural diagram there.
Okay.
Now let's move on to our next slide, that is OLTP versus OLAP. As per the usage perspective, this OLTP is used to store transactional data. And whereas this OLAP is used to store analytical data, as I have discussed previously. So, and the nature of the data that is stored in OLAP is current, detailed, and distributed. Current in the sense, whatever the data that is generated because of that particular transaction, that is very current data, right? That is current. And each and every detail of the transaction will be recorded there. So, we can term it as detailed. And distributed in the sense, as I have discussed previously, the customer details like customer name, his whatever may be the thing, all the entire details will be stored in one database. And whatever the sales, that is the stock details of our store, we are maintaining some other database for that. Let us say here. Let us say here we are storing our customer data in a PeopleSoft system, and the backend database for that is like DB2. And we are maintaining our stock details and our logistics and warehouse details in some other database, that it may be a .NET database. Okay. And these applications, like whatever the sales applications that our salespeople use, all this will be storing the data into their corresponding databases. Like with each and every transaction, what goes in the background is each and every detail will get updated there in OLTP database. Whatever the detail that is present, like if we have stock of 10, if someone purchases some product, then that stock details will be updated to 9. Okay, these customer details, whatever the customer details that you are saving there in CRM system, the customer details will be constant there. It will not be changing, or it's not, customer name will not vary for the lifetime of that customer. But based upon the transactions, our stock details varies. That is, but the end of the day, which customer has purchased which product, and if you need a report like that, we need to pull data from that DB2 as well as the data from this Oracle database. We need to club data of both these systems. So in order to club the data, it's very difficult. Like if you want to generate a report, like a yearly report, there will be a lot of joins involved. And if it is a single database, the performance will not be a major issue. Like if you are maintaining in distributed database, like each and every system, each and every application has their own database. But at the end of the day, we need to club all this data to analyze our business and to improve our business. So in order to resolve these kind of requirements, we came with the concept of this data warehouse. What we will be doing is, here we will be maintaining a fixed database with some kind of fixed tables, and we will be loading details from all these systems to that data warehouse, and it will be a single place where entire data will be available, and we can query that very easily. So I think, have I answered your question, Harish?
Yeah, okay, I'm fine with
it. And coming to, let us dig into more technical here. OLTP database, in OLTP, whatever the data that we store will be like more normalized data. Normalization in the sense that in OLTP systems, they will be taking care that no data should be repeated. So in order to avoid such repetitions, they will be normalizing the tables, like whatever the maybe the customer details, they will maintain it in some separate table. Whatever the, maybe like transactional details, they will be maintaining in some separate table. Whatever the address details, they will be maintaining in some separate table. In this OLTP system, more number of tables will be there, and there will be more number of joins. Why? Because in order to update something, it will just hit that individual table, and the data will get updated there very easily. But whereas in OLAP system, we are not supposed to do any kind of modification to the data that is present in OLAP. Why? Because OLAP is just for analytical purpose. That is, we just only read data. That's it. No one is allowed to edit data, or no one is allowed to modify data that is present in OLAP. So what kind of operations can we perform in this OLTP and OLAP systems? In OLTP systems, as it is running data and as it is business data, we will be creating data. Like if a new customer has taken membership for our store, then we will be creating we'll be entering name and his details of that customer. That is like creation of data. And partial read. Partial read in the sense we'll be verifying whether this customer has already subscribed or not. Like at the end of the transaction, we will be swiping his membership card, and we'll get a confirmation that this customer is already present. And we'll be updating. Like if someone buys some goods, then we need to update the stock details there. Like 10-1, and like deleting data. Like for let us say if some brand has stopped some product, and that product is not going to available in future, then we need to delete such products and all. But whereas in OLAP, what we do here is we just only read data. Like even though this, as I have said that some product is deleted here, right? That product details will be available in OLAP, because after 2 years, if you want to analyze business for our previous 3 years business, during that time, that product is there and that product has generated us some business. So that details will not be deleted in OLAP, because that whatever the loads that happened previously, that will stay there in OLAP. OLAP, whatever the data that will be present, it keeps on updating and the data will keep on increasing. But whatever the data that is present inside OLAP will not at all be deleted, even though that may process for years or years. Okay. And coming to data organization part, whatever the data that is present in OLTP, that will be completely based on applications. That is, each and every application generates some data, and that data will be present in OLTP. And the data will be saved in such a way that each and every application data will be stored at individual places, and they are organized based upon the application. Like sales application, all sales data will be maintained in some DB2 system. And if it is related to stock, they will be updating stock in some kind of XYZ application, and that data will be maintained in some other place. But coming to OLAP system, whatever the data that is generated, that is transferred from OLTP to OLAP, they will be organized in terms of their subjects. Like whatever that we have, like sales data, entire sales data will be put in some rack or in some table or in some schema. We call a group of tables will be present in a place called as schema in data warehouse. Okay, these terms will be something like new, but you will get used to that in coming sessions. Okay, in OLAP, whatever the data that is present, we will organize it into like subject areas. Like if you are running a business, we have customers as well as employees. All the customer details will be organized and placed in a separate schema. And all our employees details will be placed and organized in a separate schema. And if you are running like a bank will have a lot of line of business there, like loan section, like credit card section, like healthcare section, like mutual fund section, and various line of business will be there for each and every bank. And each and every data, whatever that is generated with this line of business, instead of clubbing them all together, we will maintain them in a separate organized sections. That is called each and every business line of business will have this subject, and the subject oriented data will be stored in separate places called as schemas in data warehouse. And coming to modification, as I have already discussed, in OLTP data, the data will be volatile. That is, we can keep on modifying that data. But whereas in OLAP, we will load the data whatever that is generated in OLTP, and it cannot be changed at any time. And coming to OLTP system, the number of users will be more in OLTP system. Let us say if you are working on some project that is like Amazon, the number of customers for Amazon will be in crores. And the number only analysis will be done only by through business analysts and some people involved in business. They are very limited. So in OLTP, the number of users will be more, and whereas in OLAP, number of users will be very less. And coming to data organization part here, like the way how we are going to save data in OLTP system and the way how we are going to save data in OLAP system. As I have already discussed here, in this point, like the form of data will be like more normalized. If it is more normalized, more number of tables will be there. And each and every table will have a relationship called parent-child relationship. And we can call this as, in technical terms, it is called as entity relationship. Like this table is this related to this table with this particular key. And this table A is related to table B with particular key. And this table B is connected to table C with some particular key. In OLTP system, we'll have more number of joins and we'll be having a lot of complex joins there. But whatever the data that is joined complex in this OLTP system, while transferring into OLAP system, they will be taking utmost care that this more number of joins will be avoided, even though they are not much bothered about repetition of data and wastage of space in data warehouse. But they will be bothered more about the number of joins because they want to minimize number of joins. Why? Because whenever they are querying some larger data sets like yearly transactions or transactions from past 5 years, if they want to analyze data from the past 5 years, it involves if the more number of joins are involved, there will be a lot of performance issues because it takes a lot of time to generate that kind of reports. Okay, so in order to avoid such conflicts, the utmost care will be taken while loading data from this OLTP systems to OLAP systems, and whatever the data that is present in individual tables will be joined and they will be placed at a single place in OLAP. Okay, and coming to the access part, OLTP data will be accessed by who are the customers that have accounts with us, or like our subscribers. Everyone can access their data from OLTP system. And whereas in OLAP, only the managers or the team that is involved in business development, only they will be accessing this OLAP data. Okay, is this clear to everyone? Because this is very important in order to proceed to all the next other steps.
Can I explain it again? Actually, bit confused.
Actually, at which part?
The part which you just explained.
That is related
about
to
normalization, denormalization.
Okay. Let me put this with an example here.
No, that's okay. I know about normalization.
Okay. Let's move to the next slide. I will explain that clearly here. Sorry, these slides are missing here. Actually, whatever the slides I have designed and I have opened some other file. Okay. Let's see from here. In general, that warehouse is a place where we will be storing our entire goods kind of thing in general perspective. But coming to data warehousing perspective, a warehouse is a place where we store data from different systems. Like each and every business application, they will maintain data in some separate database systems. So at the end of the day, we will be loading all the details from all the different systems into warehouse. Is this clear up to now?
Yeah.
And coming to this transactional data, analytical data, this is clear for you, right? So let's jump into here. In transaction system, that is OLTP system, we will be saving data in such a way that the data in OLTP, as large number of customers will be involved and accessing that database, that there should be no repetitions there. because there will be having like space constraints, like more data should not get wasted in that kind of databases. So in order to avoid such problems, what they will be doing is they will be maintaining data in each and every data in a separate tables, like customer details. I'll show it this as an example. Here, if it is like an employee's data, see what they will be doing in OLTP system is they will maintain data in a separate table for each and everything. Like if it is employee's data, then the employee's like details like employee ID, first name, last name, everything is present here. And what coming to the job, this job ID will, based upon this job ID, they will join, they will place job details in this separate table, and they will join both these things. And coming to job history, they will maintain it in a separate table. And coming to department, they will maintain it in a separate table. And we call this system as entity relationship. But coming to data warehouse, how they will be saving is, whatever the system, they call it as dimensional modeling. Okay, whatever the system that we use, like completely normalized system we use in OLTP, that is called as ER data model.
Which means?
ER data model means entity relationship, like primary key and foreign key relationship will be having there.
Okay. Yeah.
Entity means each and every data that is loaded is an entity. Like for our business, customer will be an entity. If it is corresponding to a sales system, the transaction that is generated with by selling a particular product, that will be an entity. Okay, each and every entity will have some interrelation, and that kind of data model, they will call it as entity relationship data model. But coming to this OLAP part, they are going to organize data in such a way that dimensional modeling is nothing but dimension. The term dimension states that the term that will not vary much, that is called as a dimension. Let me put this as an example. Each and every business involves some customers. Okay, right? If we get some new customers today, like some 10 customers have opened account in our banks today. Okay? These customer details, until and unless this customer have withdrawn their accounts from our bank, till end of their withdrawn, these customer details will not get changed, like customer date of birth, customers, like customer name, his address, whatever it may be, that will be like fixed. Okay, do you understand that?
Yeah.
And some other data, like most of that, some data will be like fixed data, like the address part. We each and every customer will open an account for our bank in some separate branches. Each and every branch address will not get changed frequently, right? All these things that will not vary much frequently, they will call them as dimensions. Okay, and facts are something that they keep on changing. That whatever the thing that will keep on running in our business, They will term it as facts. Dimensions are something like if we get a new customer, that customer details will not get varied till our business ends with that customer. So whatever the data that will not vary much, that is called as dimensional data. And whatever the data that keeps on varying during the process of our business, like sales, if customer have maintained some balance with our account and he withdraws some amount, and whatever his current balance will get updated there, and this kind of data, they will be maintaining it in facts, and they will have relationship between this fact and dimension with a single join there. Okay, let me show this example here. This is dimensional modeling here. They will maintain whatever the transaction that is going here in a fact table. Okay, And whatever the constant details, like this, let us say this table belongs to customer details. These customer details won't keep changing frequently. They will maintain these details there. They are going to maintain some bank details here. Okay. And in this bank details, the bank address will not get changed frequently. Okay. If some person has withdrawn some 10,000 from our ATM, like some customer of our bank has withdrawn 10,000 from ATM, this transaction will get stored in this fact table in such a way that this customer ID. Okay. Next, this customer belongs to this so and so bank. Bank ID. And finally, we have a measure. Measure is nothing but the data that keeps varying. Like at the end of the day, what we will be doing is group by. In the database, what we will be doing is like group by transactions will happen at the end of every month. Like this customer has maintained balance of 50,000 during start of the month. At the end of the month, he withdrawn 10,000 at some time, 11,000 at some time. I'm going to tell about that, Rajesh. Measure is something that keeps on varying. Like if you have opened account with the bank, right? The amount will be the only measure kind of thing here. Like your amount will only keep varying again, 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 and again. But your name or some other details will not keep varying. The only at the end of the day, entire business will be tallied with based upon a single column, that is account, right? Where we perform operations like sum, average, and all these kind of things, that column is called as measure column. Fact table is something where we will be maintaining that measure column, because as I have explained in this example, we will be saving details like this customer ID, this bank ID, and his present withdrawal like 10,000 rupees. Okay. This will be stored in fact. If you want to analyze these kind of data, what happens is when we query this will directly join to whatever the table from which we are acquiring some data. So very less number of giles will be present here. Even though if we want to develop a report with the data from like past 5 years, as the most of the joins are direct joins here, the retrieval time will be faster. Okay. Is everyone clear now with what is this transactional data and what is this analytical data? Is that clear, Harish?
Is it clear? If you, I'll just explain once again.
Okay.
What you said. If I'm wrong, just let me know. You're saying the dimension in which the data is present is related to the constant data, which doesn't change, like customer ID and email ID of the customer, right? That's it. And the fact is having the data which varies, like any transactions happening. Let's say I have 20,000 in my account, I just withdrawn 10,000, the remaining account will be 10,000, and all this data will be available in fact, right?
Right.
Is it right?
Right.
Okay.
If you have any new customer addition, this like if we say like for we are running like SBI Bank, we have from new 100 account new account openings today. So in this dimension table, we will have only like 100 new additions. Okay. But whereas in a fact, each and every day, lakhs and lakhs of transactions will keep on going there. With whatever the 1 lakh or 2 lakh customers that are present in this dimension. Fine. Whatever the transactions that happens on a daily basis, each and every transaction will get recorded in fact only. Is that clear?
Yes.
And whatever the data that we are to load into fact, they will be related to this dimension. and we will be relating to the dimension based upon the customer ID. Like, is this fine? Customer ID and bank ID will get recorded. Only IDs will be present. What the fact table contains is IDs of dimensions and the final transaction, that is whatever the measure that is present. Only IDs and measures will be present in fact table. Okay. Entire descriptive
measures are nothing,
measures are nothing but the main thing that we calculate every day, like account balance. We are much bothered about our account balance at the end of the day. Nothing more than that, right? Okay. Let's move to next step. That is this data warehousing architecture. Okay. With this picture, you will get clear understanding of why do we need reporting and all these kind of things. Let us put this Amazon.com as an example. Okay. In Amazon, we'll be getting some new customers will be opening their Amazon accounts by providing their email ID, their personal details and everything. Okay. All these customer details will be shared. For gathering customer details, we'll be having some CRM tools. CRM is nothing but customer relationship management. All these customer data will be maintained in an Oracle database. Okay. Inside Amazon, they need to have maintain stock of whatever the goods that are they are getting and the details of the suppliers from which they are getting, and each and every detail will be maintained in some kind. They will use some other application in order to save such data. Okay, all such data will be saved in SAP system. Okay. And all the ERP data, ERP is nothing but enterprise resource planning. Like, what are the resources, like their total number of employees, their total number of stocks, their shares details, and each and every such data will be present. They will be maintaining some other tool for that, and this tool it saves all data in some other database like Teradata. In order to build a data warehouse, what we need is we need details of each and everything. Why? Because Okay, I'll explain that to you again, Rajesh. Whenever customer joins into our organization, this customer detail will be saved in this CRM system. Okay, like business applications. In business applications, we'll be having details like in Amazon, we have 2 or 3 lakh products. For 3 lakh products, we have this much amount of stock. Okay, this much amount of stock, and this 3 lakh products will, this product, all the stock that is available in Amazon, they will be maintained by different sellers. They need to have details of that seller address and each and everything. All that kind of sellers data, their stock data, and the other such data, they will be maintaining in SAP system. Okay, and coming to their financial details, their ERP data, like if they are going to sell these many products, this for each and every product, Amazon will be getting some kind of commission. Okay, and ERP data will be like in Amazon, in order to run this Amazon business, Amazon will also have some employees there. Each and every business will have customers as well as employees. All these employees details of Amazon will be maintained in this Teradata system. Is this clear up to now? Okay, for each and every application, they are going to maintain data in their own databases. Okay, but in order to build a data warehouse, what we need is all the data should be present in a single place, so that it will be easy for us to join the data and to analyze and report. Okay, let us say we are having 3000 customer additions, and these 3000 customer additions, they all have joined, have subscription with us during a period, that is we are conducting some sale here. Okay, during this sale period, as these customers got attracted to whatever the product that is very available for cheap in your website, we got these many subscriptions during that period. Okay, if you want to analyze some scenario for our business, like I have conducted a sale on this item during some period. Okay, during that period, how many sales has happened and because of new customers? Okay, new customer details and everything will be available in this Oracle system. But coming to the sales details and total number of products that have been sold, they will be present in this system. Okay, in order to generate a report of these new customers and their transactions, we need to club data from this Oracle system and as well as this SAP system. Okay, both the data that is present in both the systems need to be clubbed. If you want to club them directly, it will be a tedious process for us, because in SAP the data will be scattered in different tables, because in OLTP servers most of the data will be normalized, and as well as in Oracle there will be a lot of joins involved, and combining these two things will be like a tedious process. So here ETL comes into picture. ETL is nothing but extract, transform and load. Once again, I am repeating, ETL stands for extract, transform and load. We are having a lot of ETL tools in market, like Informatica, ODA, DataStage, Pentaho and various other ETL tools. What is the duty of these ETL guys is, depending upon the business that we are doing, they will be generating a data model, like what should be present in the fact table, what are the details that we need to maintain in dimension table and all. They will be designing a data model for our respective business. Okay, after designing the data model, what is the regular duty of these ETL people is, they need to gather data from all these systems and they need to organize data into dimension facts. Okay, is this clear? At the end of the day, every day, what they need to do is, depending upon the business, ETL loads happens. Like for some business, at the end of the day, they will be loading data into data warehouse. For some business, they will be doing hourly loads. For each and every hour, they will be loading data into data warehouse. But during this loading process is not an easy job. During loading, they need to do some lot of transactions. Like if they are doing very small kind of business and they don't want to need details of each and every transaction, but if let us say if customer one have purchased 10 goods, but during analysis phase, the main business owners, they are not much bothered about transaction level detail. Transactional level detail is nothing but granularity. They call this term as granularity. They don't need details of each and every product that is purchased by the customer. What they need at end of the day is the customer and the sum of the transaction that has been generated by selling that whatever the 10 products that has been purchased by that customer. Okay, so such data, if they need, they want the only such data, what these ETL people do is, they will apply some operations for each and every transaction, and they will just load only that required data into the data warehouse, because the business demands only customer level data, and they need granularity up to customer only, and they are not very much bothered in detail of each customer. Okay, depending upon the requirements, the ETL people, they will be doing all filtering operations here, and they will be loading. ETL stands for extract, transform and load. As I have said previously, extraction is nothing but extracting data from all the OLTP systems. Transforming is nothing but applying business operations. Depending upon the business requirements, we will be transforming the data into the required format, and loading, the final stage. We will be loading that entire data into our enterprise data warehouse. Okay, Is this clear for everyone up to here? Harish?
Yeah,
can I move on to the next level? Okay. Now what we have done is that we have moved entire data into data warehouse. Okay. Being we are all going to learn OBA, right? Being an OBA guy, we are not at all bothered about this part. We are very least bothered whatever that is going on in the background, that is up to this data warehouse, enterprise data warehouse, we are not at all bothered about things. Why? Because what's our duty is whatever the data that comes and stores gets stored here, we need to generate reports from whatever the data that is present here. In order to get a business overview, I have explained you all these things behavior, because it will be interesting for us to learn whether what's going on in the background. So I have explained all these things, but if we enter into our job perspective, we are not at all bothered about all these systems, what will be system, what system they are using. Even if we join some organization to work on there, even though we ask managers, even the managers will not know what kind of system they will be using in OLTP system. They will just provide details of this data warehousing data warehouse details and how the tables are organized for you, and they will tell you to generate reports from the data that is available in data warehouse. Okay. It's clear up to this part, right? Okay, let's move on to next level. Our duty as a reporting people, what our duty is, we need to generate reports as per the requirements of business analysts and all. And we need to extract data from this data enterprise data warehouse, and we need to generate a report. In enterprise data warehouse, what happens is, as I have said previously, in OLAP system, they will maintain details of based on the subject area. Okay, subject area is nothing but depending upon the subject, like all the HR data will be present in a separate schema. All the sales data will be present in a separate schema. All the enterprise level data will be present in a separate schema. Schema. You just need to remember this word schema. These are all acronyms. Schema. Data mart, all this means the same thing. In a data warehouse, each and everything will be a rack. Each and every product will be maintained in some separate rack, and each and every person, each and every reporting person, they will be given access to a particular data mart, and they need to work on that data mart. Okay, is that clear? Okay. What is the duty of reporting people? Is they need to extract data from this enterprise data warehouse, and they want to display that data to the business analysts and our customers. Okay, is everyone clear up to now? Okay, up to this part, it's all about introduction, what happens in the background. Okay, now we are going to jump into our real picture, what we will be dealing with. Coming to theoretical definitions of data warehouse, but we are not much bothered about this, but in interviews, they will be asking like, what is data warehouse? How do you define a data warehouse? Something like that. We have two people, they are like Bill Lehman and Ralph Kimball. In data warehouse, they call these two people as fathers of data warehouse. As per Bill Lehman, a data warehouse is subject-oriented, integrated, time-variant, and non-volatile. subject oriented in the sense, as I have said previously to you guys, like in data warehouse, data will be organized depending upon its subject, like HR, finance, sales. Okay, the data organization in data warehouse in based upon its subject of the business, that is called as subject oriented integrated in the sense, as from the architecture diagram we came to know that we will be integrating data from various systems, we'll be integrating data from various systems, and we'll be loading all the data into a single place called warehouse. So that is called as integrated and time variant. As I have said previously to you guys, that the data will loads will happen frequently, like day to day loads or hourly loads or weekly loads. Okay, some transaction X has happened in this day and transaction Y has happened in some other day and transaction Z has opened in some other day. Each and every transaction will get loaded into data warehouse. Okay, if you want to generate a report from this time to this time, the detailed level of data will be available from this period to this period in data warehouse. So all time variant data will get recorded in data warehouse. So this is clear, right? And finally, non-volatile. Whatever the data that is getting loaded into data warehouse, no one can modify that. It is not at all volatile. No one is allowed to modify that data that is present in data warehouse. So he termed it as non-volatile. Okay, remember this definition, guys. They will be asking this definition mostly in all interviews. What is a data warehouse? So we can term this as subject oriented, integrated, time variant, and non-volatile. Okay. Now coming to, as per Ralph Kimball, a data warehouse is nothing but a place where this transactional data is structured specially for querying and analysis. This is what we are going to do as a reporting guys at the end of the day. That is, we will query data from the data warehouse and we will send the data to business analysts where they will do some analysis and they will be taking business decisions in order to improve our business there. So as for Ralph Kimball, data warehouse is nothing but a place where the transactional data is structured. The data is structured in a such a way that it will be easy for querying and analysis purposes. That is dimensional modeling. Okay. Is this theoretical part clear for you guys? Do you want to continue and proceed more, or can we stop here? Because yeah, that's fine, because okay, let us stop our class here. Let's continue tomorrow. Because if I put the entire thing in one day, we will forget that immediately. Is everything clear up to now? Because get it clarified now itself. So tomorrow we'll be jumping on into some other different topic.
Okay, I'm fine with it.
Okay, bye. Is everything clear? Rayesh? Fine.
Sorry.
Yeah.
Leaving, right?
Yeah, I'm going to leave now. Okay. In order to have an overview of what we are going to discuss tomorrow, we'll be discussing about how the data will get filtered from OLTP system to OLAP system here. That is data transformation part, and how data is organized in data warehouse. And coming to this subject area kind of thing, how the data will be present in data warehouse, and the types of columns. And after this, we are not at all going to discuss any theoretical part. From there after tomorrow, everything will be completely technical. That we are going to discuss on how we are going to work on the tool and how we are going to generate reports and all this kind of thing. Okay? Is this fine for everyone? Okay, good. Okay, bye. I'm leaving for the day. Thank you.